bring in Debbie Binder. She is the township clerk here in West Bloomfield. Debbie, you're recovered from August and on to November.
We are full steam ahead into November right now, so the recovery was short-lived.
Where do things stand? Still seeing an increase in number of people interested in voting by mail?
Absolutely. We already are preparing to send out, just based on what we have in now, over 24,000 absentee ballots. So the numbers are definitely trending upward, and our very realistic forecasting puts us at processing over 30,000, but between 32 and 36,000 absentee ballots. And we just had set a record at 16,783. So we are seeing a huge increase. You know, the reason I think I'd spoken with you before, we had a 77% absentee turnout in the last election in August. However, the turnout for the election was only 40%. We steadily have a 75% turnout in a presidential election. We're looking at between 80 and 85%, possibly up to 90% turnout for this. If we apply the same percentage of absentee, we're looking between 32 and 36,000 absentee ballots. It's going to be a busy year in the clerk's office.
And we're excited that more people are actually voting and exercising that right to do so. However, are you worried about the ability to process so many of those absentee votes?
Well, we just found out that our ballot's going to be 2 pages, it's looking like, which means it will be double. So we are going to have to figure out some precautionary steps to make sure we can get everything done. If we end up with a 2-page ballot, that will definitely affect our reporting. We had things in pretty good shape before that. So am I worried? I'm worried about things like the mail, you know, that we did have delays last time. So really what's important for us now is voter education and getting the word out to people to mail that ballot back early. Don't wait till last minute. We received 20% or 3,400 of our absentee ballots we mailed out in August on election day in the drop box. So we're trying to encourage people to both register and return their ballot early if they can this time. Plan ahead. It will save you time and it will make it easier on your clerk's offices that absolutely have a tremendous demand. As I've said to you before, I know I said running an election is a lot of work. It's challenging. Running an election with historic numbers is even more challenging. And running an election with historic numbers in the midst of a global pandemic is a whole different layer. So any support people can give by voting early, not voting early, turning in their ballot early. Nothing is counted until election day, but turning in their ballot early and making sure if they need to register that they do so ahead of time. Again, they have the right to vote or to register on the same day, but it'll help us out a lot if they're prepared and take care of turning in their ballot and registering early.
Debbie Binder with us. She is the West Bloomfield Township Clerk joining us today on the Oakland County Megacast. Debbie, we previously have had Secretary of State Jocelyn Benson on the program with us, and she referred to November's election not as election day, but more so as election week. With the influx of absentee ballots being counted in West Bloomfield and in other communities as well, do you expect there to be a delay in delivering the unofficial results of the election, and should we expect to not really know for sure what the results were until Wednesday, Thursday, or Friday of election week rather than Tuesday night as we've been accustomed to in recent elections?
You know, I would hope, our goal is still to provide those election results on Tuesday evening late. Even this last minute news as of this morning with having a 3-page ballot has changed things, that we were going to have to figure out how to process that many that quickly. I think you will see later results this time because all of your clerks are tasked with doing a double to triple the number of absentee ballots they've ever processed. And the polls are going to be, they won't be as busy, but I don't believe they will be as quiet as they were in August either. So we will see activity in the polls, in the precincts. Obviously those hours stay the same, but I do think we will take time to process those absent voter ballots. I have a goal of having it done that Tuesday night, but I think that if we're being realistic, there's a lot that's being asked of the local clerks. And some of the legislation that we are awaiting, and I believe that Secretary Benson had discussed that, some of the legislation that we're waiting for that's not moving forward that would allow us an extra day ahead of time to open the envelopes to at least get that part done and would help expedite on election day when they were being processed. but that legislation has not been moving, and that is definitely going to challenge your local clerks, who are tasked with the monumentous job of processing a historical number of absentee ballots. I think that what you do have is we joke local clerks that, you know, we're the backbone of democracy and we make it happen, and you're going to see every one of us doing our best to make it happen. But there is a reality of the number of ballots we are going to see back, and hopefully, you know, things will, again, when they come in earlier, Tyler, on the day that we get them, it's not just get it in the ballot and take it over to the absent voter counting board. You have to scan it into the state database, the qualified voter file. Then you have to verify the signature, pull the application, and take it, you know, process it incoming before it goes over to be counted. So when 20% of those came in on election day, it was a big task just to get them prepared to go over there to be counted. So the more that we can encourage people to engage ahead of time, the easier it's going to make it on all of our local clerks. And that's the message. I know one of the things they're looking into doing is getting a message out for mail it back Monday on October 19th. To kind of have that as a deadline of when people send back their absentee ballots, so that we know that we will get it in time, that it has to arrive in Michigan. I always want to remind voters in Michigan, it has to arrive by election day at 8 p.m. at this point. There is a legal challenge, but it has not been, just, you know, there's been no change at this point. Right now, Michigan law requires that ballot to be received by 8 p.m. So October 19th, I think, is a good deadline to have in mind to get that ballot in the mail. We'll be mailing them out on September 25th or right around there. We have to prepare over 24,000 to go, and we don't get them until September 19th. And from there, we have to test them on each machine, assign, prepare, stuff them, and send them. So our goal is to do that Friday morning, the 25th. What we've been telling people is to, if they don't get their ballot by mid-October, to give our office a call. Because if the ballot doesn't arrive, we can spoil the ballot that you were issued and issue you a new one. But we know the mail's delayed, so we'd like to give it sufficient time to arrive. If you are a voter who can't get up here to spoil your ballot, you may want to call us quicker than that, because you do want to allow time for the ballot to get physically mailed to you and for you to physically mail your ballot back. But just important messages. And another message I try to always relay is that, you know, there's a lot of well-intentioned focus on telling people to return their ballots to the drop boxes in at town hall or the clerk's office. And that's great advice. And we definitely encourage anybody who is able to do that. And we tell them on the phone and when they come to the counter, we recommend, if possible, returning them to your clerk's office or your drop box. But we also need people to remember, we have a large population of people. We have our military and overseas voters, college students, our snowbirds, and seniors who are in senior housing who have to rely on the mail and don't have the ability to get to town hall. So we need to make sure that they're getting that message to turn their ballots in early to allow the mail time to get it back to town hall by 8 p.m. on election day.
So Debbie, just to get the timeline down, September 25th is when people can actually start casting their ballot then, correct?
Well, we will mail them out on the 25th, and they should be available at the counter. In an emergency situation, we would be able to provide one on the 24th, but they will be available routinely at the counter on the 28th on that Monday. So a voter can also come to the counter, fill out an application here, and get their ballot and take it with them. So the ones that go in the mail, I'd be watching my mailbox probably about a week. You know, I would love to say it would be 2 days, which is what it should be. But I would say I'd watch for the week or two after that when we mail them out on the 25th. And they will be available at the counter starting on the 24th if needed. But if we can give us till the 28th, just because of the volume of absentee ballots we're going to be processing, would be appreciated. So absentee voting will technically start as soon as those ballots arrive in people's mailboxes or people get them at the window. But when I say absentee voting will start, I also want to qualify, those ballots are not counted or opened until election day at this point.
So what happens if I do vote absentee, but then maybe a person I voted for dropped out of the race? Can I cast a new ballot then?
Yes, absolutely. So what you can do, if you were to have any kind of, where somebody dropped out of the race or there was a reason you needed to change your ballot, you can spoil the ballot you were issued up to 4 p.m. the day before the election on Monday, and then we would reissue you a new one. Now, there's a little bit different process in terms of when we can last mail them out, and this is all defined by election law. You would have to sign an affidavit that we have at our office. You can also get it online, or you could just write a letter that I would like to spoil my ballot. What we need is a hand signature to verify the signature. We would spoil the ballot you were issued and issue you a new one. We cannot do that by mail after 2 p.m. on the Saturday before the election. But you can come to town hall on Monday and spoil that ballot and get a new one. I do want to point out, as I did say Saturday, we are open the Saturday before every election from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. for absentee voting. And this year we are going to expand that to the two Saturdays before that. So anybody who needs to get in here on a Saturday can come in on Saturday, October 17th or Saturday, October 24th from 9 to 12. We'll be open for absentee voting. And then on Halloween, which is that Saturday, we're required by law to have weekend hours that weekend. We'll be open from 8 to 4 for absentee voting. I'm sure that it will be busy. We're hoping to kind of encourage that early participation and engagement by offering those additional two Saturday hours. So you can, back to what you had asked, though, is you can come and spoil that ballot and get a new one. We will spoil the one you were issued and would issue you a new one if you had to change your vote. And that is a right every voter has had. It's not something that's new, and it is available by state law until 4 p.m. the Monday evening before the election.
Debbie Binder with us on the MegaCast, West Bloomfield Township Clerk. I know you can't start counting the ballots until Election Day, but does that start like at 12:01 a.m., or do you have to wait until the polls actually open?
7 a.m. is when you can start counting the ballots at this point. There is legislation that Ruth Johnson, previous Secretary of State, now Senator, has been proposing and kind of trying to push through the system to allow clerks to open the envelopes the day before, secure the ballots in a bag and start counting them physically on election day starting at 7 a.m. But so far that legislation has stalled. Clerks are working collectively to try to encourage it because we do need it with the number of ballots we're going to have to process. But no, you cannot start processing ballots until 7 a.m. on election day.
West Bloomfield Township Clerk Debbie Binder with us today. The Township Clerk's Office, also our Facebook partner on today's edition of the Oakland County MegaCast. Debbie, let's talk a little bit about election workers, because you are expecting a 75% turnout, which is relatively normal for West Bloomfield Township, and other communities are expecting similar regular turnout for presidential elections as well. With the constraints in place with COVID-19, with the increased expectation for absentee votes, does that require more people now that are going to be needed for these clerks' offices to serve as election workers, particularly for processing these absentee votes?
Yes, we absolutely need more election workers, and I am pleased to say that our efforts since the primary, our big focus has been on recruiting election workers. And we're up over 60 election workers through putting an ad in the Beacon. Every week we've placed an ad. We've sent out an ad to our listserv to get people engaged. And we've done a lot with our social media because it is important. We needed, from looking at where we were in August, we ended up going through our reserves. As people were dropping out, I was recruiting new people up to the day before the election. I don't want to have to do that this time. We'll be too busy. So we have been focusing heavily on recruiting for the last few weeks. I needed to be up at least 20 to 30 more people from August for this election, and I needed to increase the size of my database 200 to 300 so we have strong reserves for when people aren't able to come on that day. So I'm happy to say that I'm encouraged by the fact that I have 60 new voters, or 60 new election workers, but we still need more. So if anybody in your listening audience is interested, we're still looking for more election workers, and people do not have to be a West Bloomfield resident, and they have to be 16 years of age and older. And it is a paid position. I won't say it pays great per hour. It does pay $165 for election day. Plus the county is chipping in an additional $50 for November. And then it's $20 for each of two trainings, one or two trainings, depending on what position you're in. But it's a tremendous experience in multiple ways. For some of our younger people, too, it's especially a great experience in terms of it being a wonderful resume or college app job. But what we have is a lot of people who come year after year, and I always tell people, everyone complains and everyone comes back. They complain it's a long day, and it is. I won't lie. It's a long day. but you really do feel like you're part of something big and part of something rewarding. So they all come back and participate. So anyone who's ever wanted to get involved and feel like you're part of something big, this is a wonderful opportunity to do it, as well as a great way to be reassured about the process of what an absentee ballot goes through. Or if you're in a precinct, you'd be very encouraged also by the, and reassured by the process that voting, that, that all of the checks in place for voting and all of the things that people don't realize or thought of, that it isn't just take a box, put it out on the counter and take the ballots and count them. There's a lot involved in running the election, in preparation on election day and in follow-up. It's always reassuring and enlightening to people who get involved. So I can't encourage people enough to if you're looking for a way to get involved in this election. And let me tell you that there are a lot of people looking for a way to get involved in this election. This we have seen more engagement than we have seen in a long time. A great way to get involved is to work in a poll, is to work in a polling location or in the absent voter counting board. The rewards are immeasurable.
So, Debbie, I know you said it's a long day. What are the hours? Are they required to be there until that last vote is counted?
Well, if I tell them that, we won't get any right now. We don't want to discourage them before we get them. If you're in a precinct, you start at 6 a.m. and you go till, I would say, sometime between 8:30 and 10, and that you do get 2 one-hour breaks in a precinct. When you're in the absent voter counting board, it is a sequestered board, so you are not allowed to take those breaks. However, you do get breaks within the day, and we run around with a snack cart like Delta Airlines, and we feed people. And that actually is my favorite job, running the snack cart. But it starts at 7 a.m. for the AV counting board, and it realistically, is the earliest you would be out of there is 10 and probably closer to midnight. Again, we're waiting on some other legislation, and we're also waiting on an interpretation that we've heard from Secretary Benson on the law as it stands on whether we can work something out to have shifts in there. So we are exploring that right now because, you know, as I know I had mentioned once before that it sounds great, well, we'll wait for those results. The reality is we have human beings that are in there. We're going to have an absent voter counting board between 100 and 125 people. So to keep those people for 24, 36 hours is inhumane. So we are looking at options to make sure that that doesn't happen. But someone working the AV County Board does need to know it is a long day. You're looking probably at midnight. But again, people come back year after year because they do feel like they're part of something so important and part and making a difference. So if someone's looking to do that, it's a great way. And we need you. We really do. We need to make sure that even if we don't need more for this election, which we do, that we have a database that will keep us going for a long time to come. But we still do need people for this election. We have to staff precincts and kind of gauge where the absent voter numbers are coming in. As we start seeing the ballots come in, then we're going to look at how many are going to be forecast it. We're going to forecast for the precinct so that we're sufficiently staffed in the precincts as well. So the more of people we have to work with, the better off we are in terms of making sure everyone's needs can get met. And their ballots can be cast and everyone's voice is heard on election day.
Debbie Binder with us. She is the West Bloomfield Township Clerk joining us today on the Oakland County Megacast. So in terms of working as an election worker, a lot of people are inspired by being able to help their community, participate in the election process, fulfill another one of their civic duties. But some people are, especially in a pandemic, are wondering, well, what can I gain from being an election worker? And you mentioned that it looks great on the resume and it's a interesting opportunity for people. What kind of skills can people develop from being an election worker that maybe they can use in their job search as they're hopefully looking for work coming out of this pandemic or just in their everyday life?
Well, working as an election worker, one of the things I always tell people also is, and I encourage the public to be understanding, these are people who have a job that requires precision and accuracy, yet they get to practice it maybe once, twice, and maybe three times a year. So it's not something that they're having a lot of experience with. We rely on that training to compensate for what they aren't getting in experience. There are a lot of skills that are utilized when you're working in a polling location or even when you're working in the AV County Board. One is it strongly supports your interpersonal skills. You're engaging with the public if you're in a precinct, and you're engaging as part of a team if you're in the absent voter counting board. A lot of the work in the absent voter counting board is actually done in teams, all most of it and much of it in the polling location. So you're learning to work as part of a team in a job that requires accuracy, precision, accountability, and just, you know, paying attention to detail. So I think there's a lot of skills that are encouraged by getting involved in being an election worker. And I think that if you were doing your resume or your college app, there really are some strong skill words that you could include as part of your resume even when you wrote it down, you'd say, wow, I didn't realize I did all that. It is an involved process that you use a lot of skills.
So Debbie, what is the training and can people do that virtually now?
We offered virtual last time. Well, we didn't offer. We actually offered for people to participate in the county. And we're preparing, actually Civic Center TV has been extremely helpful in making sure that we can be prepared to have a virtual version if we need to go that route. The feedback has mostly been that people do prefer to have the hands-on and coming in and having the training in person. However, we do recognize that we don't know where we'll be with COVID at the point that we're training. So we want to make sure that we have a secure and option ready to go if needed, as well as even for reinforcement. I have had quite a few inspectors say to me, again, we rely on training to give them a job that requires precision and accuracy. They would love to come to the trainings two or three times. So by having something that we've been working with you guys to create, they'll be able to watch that after if they need more support before election day. And we have, I feel very lucky. We have such a committed group of people working on elections that they do take it seriously and they do come in and practice and they would engage watching that video over again. Actually, as I say that about our election workers, I do want to mention that next Monday night at our board meeting, we will be honoring our election workers as well as our polling locations with a resolution at the board. Actually, the board will be considering it. But we are very grateful for our election workers. And I don't want to actually miss saying that we are extremely grateful for our polling locations. I tell people all the time, we need our polling locations a lot more than they need us. We are work for them. They have to bring people in early. They have to keep people late. They have to clean up. It's really a commitment for them that they're doing to be a community partner and support their community. We are extremely grateful for that. We have few options that we can use as a polling location. It has to be a public building or a nonprofit, and it has to, you know, clearly have sufficient parking, and it does have to be within the jurisdiction. So our choices are often few. We have, you know, schools and churches and synagogues and temples and different locations that have been offering their space to us year after year after year, as well as some of our parks building and some of our community assets. But we don't have a lot of choices. So without people making those polling locations available to us, and our poll workers who are willing to come in and make it so that we can conduct that election, it would be impossible. So we will be honoring all of those people, our polling locations and our election workers on Monday. My hope was to be, we originally had this on the agenda for March, but when COVID hit and we went virtual, I was hoping to wait until we were going to be able to have an in-person and have people come into town hall for that meeting. But it looks like that's not going to happen in the immediate future. So we decided to bring it back and just let our people know, our people and our locations know how much we appreciate all that they do to help us run successful elections. Without them, we wouldn't be able to do it. And we know that.
So Debbie, just a couple more minutes here with you on the Oakland County Megacast. If someone is considering, becoming a poll worker, can they pick if they want to do the precinct versus counting the absentees, and do they get paid that day?
No, they get paid. They're paid through our payroll department, so they're paid. It's usually, it depends if it could be a week or two later on the township payroll schedule. But yes, they do. We do take requests. One of the things we always ask people, and when I'm recruiting somebody, I say, can you be away from your phone for the whole day? And I don't say that judgmentally because I couldn't. But to be in the AV counting board, you are away from your phone. It is sequestered, so you can't have any electronics that access outside information. So from 7 a.m. until after 8 p.m., you would not be able to have a phone. So we always kind of let people know that, you know, right away. The AV counting board is where we have needed more people lately just because of the sheer volume. The AV counting board is a little bit more sedentary. So somebody who's looking for something more sedentary may prefer that. And it's also a controlled environment because we have an AV counting board and you don't have the public coming in. So we do, with COVID, we take steps to take temperatures and screen them when they arrive in the morning, and we provide masks and shields and copious amounts of hand sanitizer to make it as safe of an area as we can, as well as putting up these porta walls to separate the air, to create physical barriers. So if someone works the AV counting board, it is a more controlled environment, where if they're in the precinct, you do have the public coming in to vote. So it's a little bit less controlled, a little bit more active, and you do get 2 1-hour breaks. So it kind of depends what the specific voter's looking for and what level of engagement is better for them. We usually have that conversation with them, and we get people who are willing to work in the AV counting board, so that we can always call back, you know, fall back on that. When we staff a precinct, it's not just let's take a list of 10 people and put them in a location. We have to look at different things. We have to look at their skills, if they're able to use the computer. We have to look, we try to keep them close to home, and we have to have both parties represented in each precinct, because a lot of the tasks that are done in the precincts and in the AV County Board require the presence of people from two different parties. So we need to make sure that our staffing includes a skill, you know, enough and sufficient people with the right skills, and making sure that we have both parties represented to get the tasks that need to get done. So it's a big job. The staffing alone, you know, Jim in my office is the one who does the staffing. If anyone does want to volunteer to get involved, call 248-451-4848 and ask for Jim Allen. Again, it's 248-451-4848 and ask for Jim. But it's a daunting task that Jim has in terms of playing dominoes, because when he has one person drop out, it's not just as simple as I'm going to replace one person. He has to look at the skills in the party and the location and do the best he can of staffing. And I also want to remind you that we, from a staffing perspective, on election day, we swell up to an additional 250 to 350 people. So it's a pretty significant size staff we're working at. We double town hall staff on election day. So our payroll person also takes time to get those checks issued, because she's got to do a payroll that's twice as big for that, for just election work. It's a big undertaking to run an election.
I'm telling you, you're listening to the Oakland County Megacast on 89.3 WBLD Orchard Lake, 88.1 WBFH Bloomfield Hills. Debbie Binder, the West Bloomfield Township Clerk, with us on the Oakland County Megacast. Debbie, we have you on the show quite often, and I always learn something new every time you are on. And I will say, being sequestered all day without your phone, that is a challenge. I won't be signing up, Tyler.
Oh, no.
You know what, though? It's a challenge, but it's also so rewarding that we have people who come back year after year, and they really, really love it. I receive requests right after August from people who want to be with the same people on their team. They had the best day. They enjoyed working with their teammates. So it's, you know, it's kind of going back to learning how to interact with other people. So, you know, I really did not have a lot of complaints from the people who were in there about being away from their phones. They managed to interact really nicely with each other, built new friendships, new relationships. And again, I had to have within the 3 days after the election, I had at least a dozen emails from people telling me who they wanted to work with again. So they do get, you know, there's a camaraderie, there's a commitment, and there's an engagement that they're getting out of it, and reinforced socially, that makes it worth it. They do come back. They complain a lot more about the long day, and it is a long day, but they all come back and do enjoy the experience.
It might be nice to be without your phone for a day. Take a break. Debbie, anything that we didn't talk about? I feel like we covered everything under the moon, but anything we didn't talk about that you want to add before we let you go?
I would say my two parting thoughts, and one actually is I'm going to divert to our old friend issue, is the census. And we actually had a bump this week, which we haven't had a bump in a while. We're up to 80.5% participation. And we were typically between 119 and 121 in the state in terms of our response rate compared to other municipalities. And we bumped up to 112. So West Bloomfield, you can do it. Respond to your census. 2020census.gov. Be counted, be heard, and bring the money in for any, you know, that's what any federal money that comes to us in representation is based upon. And I know that most of us would rather it's based on as close to 100% of our population as can be. So 80% is definitely improvement, but I'd like to see us continue responding and get us up to that 100% participation rate. Yeah. And then the last takeaway is just to really encourage people to you know, get think for this election, try to do everything early. Try to submit that ballot early. If you can bring it back to town hall and use one of our drop boxes on the east or west side of town hall, that would be preferable. But if you can't, make sure you mail it with sufficient time for that ballot to get sent back here. And if you need to register, the same thing, please try to do it early. I think that's the message this year is don't delay. Try to make everything you do, you know, early and ahead of time. This is not a year to procrastinate, because if you procrastinate, it's not even just selfish that it makes our life easier. It makes your life easier, because you will encounter more lines and more delays if you wait till last minute. So I am just trying to get that word out. Please try to participate, whatever your level is, and make sure that you're ahead of the game.
Debbie, real quick before we let you go, back to the census. I know that you can do it online. It takes, it's less than 5 minutes. But if I don't have my census card with the information, can you just go on to to fill it out?
You can just go to 2020census.gov, and there's a button. I can't remember what it says. It says, I think it says respond. And you just go to that, press that button, and it walks you through putting your address in and all of it takes less than 5 minutes. I think it's 9 questions. And you're done. You can also, there's a phone number. I don't have the phone number right here, but there's a phone number to call your census in. So there are a lot of ways to respond. They do have people in the field taking account, but they're not going to probably hit every home. So if you can self-respond, that will make sure that you're counted, as well as keep somebody from coming to your door. It's really, again, like you said, it's as easy as can be. It takes minutes to respond online or get the phone number. If you just search 2020 census phone number, do a Google search, you'll get the phone number, call in, and just be counted. It's really important. Our federal funding and our representation all depend on that accurate count. And it is, you know, we've talked before that count is for the next 10 years. So having as accurate of a count affects you for a long period of time. It's not just, okay, we'll do it again next year. This is a 10-year count. So please make sure that every one of us is counted in West Bloomfield. And when we have any kind of a disaster, or right now we're dealing with a lot of grant money coming in from federal government pertaining to COVID. And all of that money coming in is based on our census count and our population. A lot of things for voting that we're getting in are based on your population. So making sure that we have the most accurate representation of our population is important. And as nice as it was to see an 8 at the beginning of that number, I'd like to see a 9. And they did move the deadline up a month. So now the deadline is the end of September, which means we've got to get cracking. We've got to get people who have not responded. Please take a moment now and go to the website or call in, or if you do have your questionnaire, send it in. Let's get as close to 100% count as we can. We are seeing firsthand how important those numbers are and the money that we're getting back for COVID-related expenses. And a lot of those COVID-related expenses directly affect elections. Our election costs have increased hugely, just the postage on our absentee voting. And we have been able to secure, with the help of federal government and with the help of our county government, who has been extremely involved and extremely helpful. They have provided many assets and many resources for us to use to help with the election process. And all of that is based on our census count. So again, I probably should go out of my way to thank what the county has done to make, Commissioner Gershenson speaks at every meeting. And she has spoken with you as well. The County Board of Commissioners has gone out of their way to make sure that the clerks, local clerks' voices are heard, and that they're doing the best that they can to help make sure we have the resources needed to meet this challenge that we are meeting with this election. And so all of that is based on our registered voter numbers, which are over 54,000, and our census count. So please, the more that everybody can get involved, the more they're able to do for us and make it easier. So I would like to thank all of those people who are involved in making sure we have the resources, as well as Civic Center TV, who anytime I've called and said we have a project we need to do to get the word out, you have been more than available. So I appreciate everything everybody is doing for us to help and meet the challenge of what is coming in November, which we all know is going to be a large election with a large turnout. And you're going to see some of the vitriol from the country, spilling into the election. So we're hoping to keep our elections safe and secure, and everybody having the opportunity to have their voice heard.
Debbie Binder, thank you so much for taking time out of your busy schedule to be with us on the MegaCast and update everyone with everything that is going on out of your office.
Thank you both for your time. I appreciate everything you do.